know, the initial thing.
Yeah.
And y'all came back and looked at it and said, I guess, okay. And they filled it up, and then I had
before we begin with our next topic on the agenda, that is community growth, I want to make some comments to y'all concerning our vision, our strategic vision. You'll note a page on the inside of your binder concerning vision. The screen we have up here, the shot we have up here, is a quote that I would like to use with y'all. This was something that has come from the strategic leadership and decision making document, and you'll see that everybody has these problems with trying to define vision. I've come to believe that we need a vision to guide us, but I can't seem to get my hands on what vision actually is. I've heard a lot of terms like mission, purpose, values, and strategic intent, but no one has given me a satisfactory way of looking at vision that will help me sort out this morass of words. It's frustrating. I think that is exactly what we are doing here as a commission, looking for data, taking the information that we have. What does that tell us about where we are currently? What does it give us an indication of the future? And how do we move forward in reaching that particular goal that we have as a community? You follow this as far as defining the vision. It must be realistic, credible, attractive, and future. I think y'all all would agree that we have to be realistic in what we are anticipating to come out of this two-day retreat. We have to be realistic about what our abilities are. We can talk about what Lowndes County can become, but if it is not realistic, then we are just spending a lot of time spinning our wheels. And it has to be believable. It's got to be something that we can actually accomplish. And it's got to be attractive enough to promote and motivate us as an organization, as well as the support of the public. So, this is a breakdown that you again see in your booklet. You look at those items as to what a good vision will actually consist of. I hope it will help you make your way through this. And I also would like for you to be aware of our mission statement. I think most of y'all have seen this. Commissioner Evans helped give birth to this a number of years ago. I think it is still relative. I think it is still important to provide an efficient, effective, and responsive local government to all citizens of Lowndes County while maintaining the financial strength to meet any contingency. If y'all believe that that is not reflective of our core belief and our values, then we need to spend time changing that. As far as I'm concerned, I believe that is still as relevant today as it was
10 years ago.
It was 10 years ago that we came up with this.
Yeah, that statement's pretty well timeless. I mean, I don't know that it will ever be ineffective.
I will tell you that that was not thought of off the top of the commissioner's head. That took a considerable amount of time to see if that statement actually defined what they intended and what they wanted to accomplish.
The only thing I would add is, you know, when we talk about vision, I think somehow we need to incorporate leading as an original hub. And I don't know the wording, but you know, as we go to think about that, because when I look at Tifton and how it's running and how the surrounding counties are going, I just, my thought, when I think about vision for Lowndes County, is somehow leading and maintaining the status as a leader in this hub.
Yeah, I think if you go to a lot of these communities, if you ask them would they be interested in trading place with the benefits and the assets and the circumstances they have with Lowndes County, I doubt that there's any of them that wouldn't readily change places with us. So while we have a lot of work to do, I think we're far better than we sometimes realize. This goes back to those items of the right vision, attracting commitment and energizing people, which obviously results in citizen engagement, which is something Commissioner Evans has talked about a little bit. For employees to feel that they are productive and efficiency makes for a better workforce, and therefore we are able to provide to our citizens the services that they anticipate and in some cases exceed those expectations. I think you will see if you talk to all of the department heads, none of which are behind me, they will acknowledge that they each have a standard of excellence in their departments that they push and encourage their employees to strive for. And it bridges the present with the future. If we anticipate a vision or create a vision that really is not able to be reached and measured, and we're just wasting our time and spinning our wheels. This quote here is important. This came from Joel A. Barker. He's the first technician. He's a futurist, business and technology futurist. He's the person who came up with a paradigm shift as a buzzword in business development. Vision without action is merely a dream. Action without vision is just passes the time, and vision with action can change the world. I don't mean that to come across as a beauty pageant answer. I mean that to be the world in which we live in each and every day. Applying these now, it's what we hope to be able to accomplish with you guys. How do we manage our growth, development, our facilities, our community, the public safety? We've already talked about our finances and how that is key to the development of all of these items, that is, to me, again, is critical, is the foundation, cornerstone, and that leads us to all of these other items. So, as you work through the next day or so, if you ask yourself these questions, I think you will be able to help form the type of vision that will be beneficial and will be one that you will be able to take away and apply every day through the coming year. Any comments, any questions, any feedback?
Well done.
We let him back in. You want me to?
He's trying to make himself comfortable.
We're going to begin, if you look in your book, as on the growth, infrastructure, and development growth. And we are going to, we'll have these slides up on the screen so you can follow it through the book or through our screen. We are going to begin with roads. And we start with the roads and that existed in 2013. Meanwhile, back at the ranch. Here we go. Mike, you want to make any comments concerning this? Come up here, or y'all can pull a little bit closer.
The first slide is just a kind of a basic overview of where we were in 2013. Mr. Pritchard charged us with kind of showing where we were 5 years ago, where we are today, and where do we see things going in the future, where's our vision. So if you look at the next slide, this will show you the red roads that you see are new roads that have been built within subdivisions that developers have built. The green roads are roads where the county has done improvements through SPLOST funding. And so basically, this is the map as we sit today with the ones in red are our new roads that have been, like I said, been built by developers. So where do we see it going for future SPLOST and for T-SPLOST? If if everything passes the T-SPLOST and hopefully the next SPLOST date, these are. These are my visions for where we go. Where do we see development happening? Where do we see a need? And these are kind of our areas that we're looking to do some road improvements, some road paving, and it takes in just about every aspect, every part of the county in some shape or fashion.
Y'all have seen, I think, provided by the chairman, the anticipated T-SPLOST project that would be under consideration for the
Where are we having traffic problems now?
Where are our biggest traffic problems now is on the north end of the county when still on that section of 41 coming from Grove Point down into North Ballester Road. We're having a lot of, we're starting to experience a lot of growth in that Valdale Road corridor with the Moody Family Housing, with the Nelson Hill subdivision, with the water and sewer being there. I continue to see that area blossoming. The Natco property is fixing to come out of its lease.
Where is that?
That's the property on behind Cass Birch. It runs all the way over to Valdale, and then on the other side, which runs all the way over to the Super Bridge McMillan areas. I mean, I just continue to see that. I mean, that, all that property there is fixing to come out of that 50-year conservation, and I believe that, you know, that part of that's fixing to get developed. Because I know that they're working with some locals on doing some master planning in there. Natco is a big timber company out of Atlanta that is tied in with PCA.
This is a projection of those of the county road system, assuming that SPLOST or T-SPLOST projects are successful.
Along with what we've done, you know, currently, and the new roads that have been built. This is what we, where we foresee our, in the future, this future map to look in 10 years. And this is, again, this is the higher area that, where we're seeing all the growth. You get that, that, you know, northern corridor, 41, Valdale, over towards the Bemis area, and with the water and sewer there, I see it just continuing to go. It's a very developable area.
Mike, can you take a second and kind of highlight the roads and the significance of those roads for the proposed T-SPLOST projects?
Okay.
For example, I mean, you've got them in purple here.
Right.
And if you look behind the T-SPLOST tab, just on the other side of the presentation,
too far ahead.
There's a list there. No, I think we can
do it here. Can you go back one slide? The first T-SPLOST project is the old Clyteville Road widening from 75 down to Owsley. On big event days at Wild Adventures, old Clyteville Road can't handle the traffic. We still have backups all the way to, you know, the next 13 to 4 miles. We still have traffic backing up there. We still have issues getting people out of there. From a traffic management standpoint, that road needs to be expanded just to grow, and that whole area around it is needs to grow and provide alternate routes to get people out of there.
Now, that part of Old Clyteville Road, we go into a 4-lane.
I'll do a 5-lane.
A 5-lane.
Okay. 5-lane with turning lanes. The second project is on T-SPLOST is exit 11. The DOT added this project in with our T-SPLOST list, and they're going to put in some money with it, and they're looking for some T-SPLOST money to help offset the cost of that project. Is that correct?
Correct. Because the legislation said that you had to have throughout the whole region 30% of the projects had to be GDOT projects. So that's really kind of how that project, that wasn't on the original list, but it was added because we needed that GDOT. And then they kicked in like a $21.5 million project proposed, and then they committed $20 million.
Right.
For the project.
The next project on the list is the old 41 widening, phase 2 and phase 3, which phase 2 goes from North Valdosta Road up to Dasher Grove, and then the phase 3 will go from Tillman Crossing up to Union. So those, that's the phase 2 and phase 3 of that. That's the number 3 project on the list. Number 4.
And that's going to be basically what we did in that section. They're going to do 3-lane, they're going to do 4-lane.
From Dasher Grove down to North Alaska Road, we're gonna transition from a three-lane to a five-lane because we have 100-foot right-of-way in that section. We're gonna be able to, and that section right there is where we see the most traffic, right there kind of in front of the fire station, from right in that fire station, Stewart Circle area, on down. Because one of the biggest things that what we see right now is from a traffic standpoint, is that intersection of Stewart Circle and 41 is at a below par rating as it sits right now. To get it up to standards, to have it above to a passable grade that we're comfortable with, the widening that needs to go up to a five-lane section.
And that's not the north part of Stewart Circle.
That's right. 41. That's right.
But as that road makes that transition away from the railroad track, then that's when you get the wider right-of-way at that point. Kind of confined, otherwise we're just running parallel with the track.
Now, phase three will be a three-lane.
Yes,
we phase up to
you. That's right.
And Mike, is that Clydesdale in purple going back over to north of the Valdale?
We're gonna get to that one, that's number six. Number four on the list is the shallow road widening and the bridge replacement. As you know, the bridge there at Frank's Creek goes underwater when we have the backups, the big floods, and that bridge needs to be raised. And with the widening of the shallow road, North Alaska Road bridge and everything, we're gonna extend that through that bridge and out to Snake Nation just to accommodate for that traffic in that area right there. The Ore Road extension. Ore Road dead ends into it. Well, it runs from Cherry Creek Road over to Skipper Bridge Road, but the county has 80 foot of right of way that was donated to us back in the 80s that will take all the way over to Bemis Road. And if we could get the road in from Skipper Bridge Road over to Bemis, that would take a lot of traffic off of that southern portion of Skipper Bridge and would be able to get people over to and from Bemis Road a lot quicker. And it brings them out at a traffic signal on Bemis Road. So it's a great location to extend that road on through. The next one is Clydesdale Road and Simpson over there off of 41, from 41 over to Valdale. We included Simpson in this just for the simple fact of getting a second means of ingress and egress that's paved out of. But this is a very developable area. We've got a lot of people that have talked to Jason and I and Steve about doing development out there, but the fact that it's still on a dirt road, it's just not economically feasible for them to do it and try to pave the road. But we expect whenever this comes through, that we can see anywhere from 4 to 6 pieces of property get developed out there. Then we go back down to the Wild Adventures area, Brixton Road. Brixton Road is right basically across from the entrance to Wild Adventures, and Brixton Road will get you all the way across over to Madison Highway. Pave that road, put up some railroad improvements there. That'll get us all the way over to the Madison Highway. So the people coming out of Wild Adventures can get over to Madison Highway quickly. Can get you right down to exit 11 or get across that. Up at the north end, Cooper and Hightower, up around the base. You know, a lot of this is just for security, to be able to close that section of Hightower Road right there along that north runway. The Hickory Grove Road Bridge at the Eccles County line. There's two bridges down there that need to be replaced. And so both of those will be replaced. But we will probably do that. We'll probably phase that, do one bridge, and then do the next bridge, because if we don't, that messes up a detour. So if you're you're very familiar with that one as I am.
Doing both at one time. That's up to Detour.
That's up to Detour. Back down to the Wild Adventures area, the Kinderloo-Clytville Road, that's the paved road that kind of comes off at an angle to the northwest. It is, a portion of that is paved up there where the purple line stops. But this will get people from coming out of Wild Adventures. They can come up Kinderloo-Clytville Road, get over to Rocky Ford or to Owsley, and get out towards the Brooks County area. A lot easier than having to go back up to the interstate and go to exit 16. Coleman Road Northwest. If this is the road that comes out of right there by the Hayhower Elementary School, that'll take you over towards Bowdell Road. This road here, it'll alleviate a lot of traffic. This is one of our busier dirt roads. It's got a lot of traffic on it. And I think that this road here, this will be a good project to pay just because of the fact that of the traffic that's on it now, get people to and from the elementary school and the middle school right there in Hayhower.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. I was just going to say, it does come from Bowdell and comes in just south of the Hayhower Elementary School up there, so it does get to their traffic.
So, and what you see in the mornings, you see a lot of people that live over in that Bowdell area or the Skipper Bridge areas that are coming, bring their kids to school. That's the road they live on, or they drive on, getting their kids into school instead of coming down 122. Twin Lakes Road is really a connector road from Lotlaw Road over to 41 down in the south end. We've already got utilities down in that area, and there's a piece of property down there that's probably going to be developed in the near future. This is a good connector road. And then the last road is Hall Road, which will go from Union to Old 41 and then all the way to Bowdell. This is another road that gets a lot of traffic, Hall Road, and all that is cut through traffic. And so what we did in T-Splosh, we took the approach of where did we see good connector roads? What were good connector roads? What could alleviate traffic from the higher areas, the Bowdell roads, the old 41s, those roads like that, but also what are the dirt roads that people are using? And so that's kind of the approach that we took. And then the unconstrained list, these are what we used here. If we went through and looked at subdivisions that were built back before the county had subdivision standards that would allow you to build a subdivision on a dirt road. These subdivisions are already built out. Arapahoe Trail, Burke Calder Subdivision, Cheyenne Way, Country Estates East and West, the Deerfield Subdivision, Madison Heights, Pine Cove East, and Pine Cove Farms. All of these subdivisions, we've already got the 60-footer right-of-way. The roads are good and wide. All we need to do is come in there and work the base, work the ditches, and they're ready to be paved. So no right-of-way acquisition. You'll see them in your book whenever you get to the T-Splosh page. We have no money in there for right-of-way acquisition because we won't need it, because all of it is platted 60-foot right-of-way.
Are those in the near future?
Those are if T-Splosh passes in May.
Future funding.
They're on the master list up here.
Yeah, they're on your they're not on the actual project. That's 25% of the funding that we will get if T-Splosh passes. That's those unconstrained projects will come out of that 25%.
That was about $82 million
worth that you just built, right? Yes. Yes, sir, right at 82 million. So if you put the 70 million here, yes, then the 11, right.
So the other, say,
8
million would be this discretionary, I guess,
we're talking about. No,
the total benefit of what Lowndes County, not the city, but just Lowndes County, is around 92 million, but that's the increase in the percentage of the difference between the 30% in the LME down to the 10%. It'll drop down to 10% tax on the LME funding. So that'll come in there. I think what Commissioner Marshall, and this may be something to we can bring up later, in the projects that were originally submitted, there were 14 total projects that were submitted, but through the process, there was two projects that fell off of that list. Commissioner Marshall has a concern, an illegitimate concern, about one of those roads which currently serves cemetery, Palmberry Cemetery, that possibility that we need to look at least extending that pavement on down to that point of that cemetery. Because as he brought up, the city cemetery is now full, or at least all the plots are sold. And so more of these cemeteries out in the rural areas are going to get a little bit more pressure on than what they have in the past. So I think we may need to go back and look at that and tweak that. And that, again, is some of the other projects. I mean, work some of those through future SPLOS, through some of the unconstrained funding, and, you know, some of that is a possibility of how we can get some of those roads done.
Okay. That's just kind of an overview of that north end of the county.
Any questions for Mike before we go into the water and sewer?
I think you're probably going to answer it, but I mean, that was my thought process was, okay, with these improvements, with the road improvements, is water and sewer going along with that, and then the attractiveness of these new roads, paved roads, what that's going to do to the development community. And then from a planning and zoning perspective, are we prepared for growth in those areas?
Well, I think that initially when Mike was looking at all of these projects, and Mike can speak for himself, but basically what I saw is that from the T-Splosh projects, those roads addressed potential for development in the future. They affect economic development, such as the ones down at in the Wild Adventures area and the Old Clydeville Road. Wild Adventures, again, is a big part of our local economy. It brings people into our community. And so being able to give them every opportunity so that there's no traffic congestion and ease that was important. The Cooper Road and Hightower Road issue up there is an issue that we've been looking at and been kind of hanging there for several years, and that really is for the benefit of Moody Air Force Base. It's another one of those little pieces that hopefully in the future will help secure Moody Air Force Base. So all of the projects that were submitted had a very, very specific rationale behind why they were selected, so that the community could benefit from residential development, and in some cases certainly commercial development, to also enhance and protect our existing economic development engines in our community, as well as Moody Air Force Base. So a very good job of doing all that.
We're going to do that on the next SPLOS. If that one's designed and ready to go, we're going to do that on the next SPLOS.
What we wanted to do is to give you all a broad picture of the community growth and development that Scotty was referencing. So by going into now the water and sewer, we will come back and tie in planning and roads along with the water and sewer. So, Steve, as you go.